Star Wars Episode II, Revenge of the Fifth. Revelry abounds and excitement reigns over the galaxy as what was once one day of celebration turns to two. In days of yore, tales were retold of the Golden Age of Jedi, the diplomacy of Senator Amidala, and the tragedy of the fallen younglings at the temple. As one triad concluded, another began, a rebellion built on hope that gave way to the story of a determined princess and an ambitious farmer. But on the horizon looms the ever-present danger of the Sith. In a small outpost in the Pennsylvania system, a pair of rebellion fighters plot to bring peace back to the galaxy. Following the lessons of Rey Skywalker and General Leia Organa, they will restore faith to the franchise and peace to the fandom through a democratic discussion of the conclusion of the Skywalker saga.
So this now brings us to probably the most critically acclaimed film of the franchise, and probably the most universally beloved one of the franchise, and quite frankly, the film that changes the course of film history.
Oh, bold.
So that's Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back.
It's a bold statement, but I like it, because I think what you can't... So there, I think there is... Something that a lot of people seem to agree upon is that when they talk about, like, what they think the quote-unquote best Star Wars movie is, like, film-wise, they seem to, you know, point pretty critically to The Empire Strikes Back. And I think you're right, because there are so many things about this. I mean, the reveal alone of Vader as Luke's father, which...
What? No!
Hey, you keep that in Revenge of the Sith where that belongs. But, you know, it's this incredible reveal. It's, you know, often quoted, or rather often misquoted.
Yes.
But there are so many incredible iconic scenes from this and iconic moments. And I mean, I know we said that a lot about New Hope as well,
yeah.
Because that's definitively fair. But I think you're right. This does something to cinematic history and the investment level with the Star Wars franchise that can't be denied.
Well, you're saying iconic shots, and I agree with you. We can get repetitive talking about that if New Hope and then Empire back to back. But I think these are the two films that are that. They have that.
Yeah.
Even above, you know, Return of the Jedi, which we'll get to shortly, there's so many moments that transcend the film or the franchise, right? Like, your people that, you know, why you've never seen Star Wars, I don't know.
It still doesn't make sense.
But if you have it, you know it.
Yeah.
You know that moment of Darth Vader. You know Han and the Kryptonite. I'm sorry. Carbonite.
If you know Han and the Kryptonite, please tell me what table at a Comic-Con you got that movie
right.
on.
So, like, you know these moments. Like, it's, they're just, like I said, they transcend the franchise themselves.
Well, and, you know, probably even if you're not a Star Wars fan, you know who Yoda is. You probably have seen somewhere Do or Do Not, There Is No Try.
Yeah.
Like, so I think that's, like, the interesting thing about this.
Well, I mean, look at Baby Yoda was huge for people that weren't watching The Mandalorian because they know Yoda. I mean, who? Yeah.
Yes. And I recently had a conversation with someone who was not a Star Wars fan, got into Star Wars because of The Mandalorian.
Gotcha.
They started watching it on Disney Plus.
That makes sense.
Fell in love with The Mandalorian, loves Grogu, and it made them, like, they actually talked about, she was like, in her family, like, their family unit became Star Wars fans because of that. It's a really cool thing. But you have to know some of that recognition of going, well, I've seen Yoda before.
Right.
You know, so
yeah.
This, and you know it's a big deal when Grogu
right.
shows up because of Yoda.
And it's kind of funny because, again, most of us seeing these films as kids, that I forget that Yoda isn't in the first film.
Oh, yeah, completely. Or you think, like, well, Yoda's in most of the movie, and then you're like, no, he's not.
Yeah.
He's really not. And then when he shows up in the third one, it's to die.
Oh, come on. Frank Oz, he needed a little bit of a break. He couldn't be under Dagobah the entire film.
Just down there with that X-Wing.
Yeah.
You know, so Empire Strikes Back is obviously incredible. That goes without saying. It's going to be almost impossible, I think, to find any low notes in this. Talking high notes, like, for me... And I hate even saying there's one particular sequence that's my favorite because I feel like that's so unfair because then I'll contradict myself later and say about something else. But man, the ice planet Hoth, it just gives and it gives. It is a planet, barren wasteland, but fruitful with iconic moments.
Yeah, I mean, just the opening alone, and it's tough because you have to have that scene written in of, you know, with Luke getting captured and getting scarred because of what happened to Mark Hamill in between the films, and having a car accident and having a little bit of, you know, unfortunately being scarred from the accident.
Yeah.
They had to write that in. So I give a lot of credit to the writers and to Mark Hamill and allowing that scene. But it's done really well. And really, again, you know, we've said it 1,000 times. We'll say it again. Iconic. Like, this great, you know, shot of the Wampa and, you know, Luke in the cave.
Yeah. The puppet Wampa.
Yeah.
The big old puppet.
Yeah.
Some CGI nonsense. Yeah.
There's a deleted scene. Again, we've seen, there's so many different versions. I don't know if it's actually in one of the versions of actually a longer, I believe it's actually in this version that we were just watching, and I may just not be remember, where there's, you get more of the Wampa.
Yeah, it's in the edited, you know, whatever year that those got changed over.
It's great. It adds more to that, and then you have Luke getting the lightsaber.
Yeah. And then Han coming to save him.
Yeah.
Like, you know, so I have this, like, fantastic sleeping bag, which is a tauntaun, and it has a lightsaber for the zipper. When you pull down the side, you can actually see the tauntaun guts on the inside. I know it sounds, like, really disgusting, but it's actually kind of adorable. Sorry, I have to share. It's really comfy, too.
Again, another t-shirt down the line for us. Wampa guts, I mean, tauntaun guts are adorable.
Well, it really is. It's very cute how they did it. The company doesn't exist anymore. It's called Think Geek. They were like, you served by GameStop. But, like, you know, there's so many iconic moments in that. And then, you know, and I love you brought up about, like, Mark Hamill and them having to write in, you know, unfortunately, this accident, like, into the story. But I even think about, like, this is what's so great about Lucas, because the world building is so intense that he created essentially, like, this med bay, like, water pod that he's in with all of these, like, tubings. And I'm like, they could have literally had a line and then showed him with, like, a bandage. But they're like, no. We've got to do this better than that. We have to show him this way. We have to show him in this pod. Like, and I don't know. I think that adds something to that. And it's that kind of commitment to moment and commitment to story that I really appreciate.
What did you say, Luke? You're going to look great in a diaper in the water.
It wasn't like an unfortunate diaper situation they give him, but I don't know what else you're supposed to.
No, it's great. Again, kind of reminiscent of Finn showing up in The Last Jedi, you know.
Oh, yeah. You know, in that med suit. Yeah. His is cooler, though.
I would have to mention, too. I mean, Lucas gives up directing control on this film to Ian Kirshner. So that's an interesting kind of dynamic to this because how, you know, again, acclaimed that this film is, that Lucas, even though he gets all the credit, it's a very, you know, very Nightmare Before Christmas, right? Where, you know, and he should. This is Lucas' baby, but Kirshner deserves a lot of credit.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Do you think this is better directed than New Hope?
It is.
You say that with hesitancy, though, which I find interesting.
I do. There's just so much that Lucas does with New Hope that was groundbreaking for 1977. I mean, and stuff that we didn't even get into. I mean, the fact that that film holds up so incredibly well today is just a testament to him.
Well, it's also a testament to the prop department. You know, the building of those models.
I mean, it wasn't just him.
I'm saying this under Lucas's direction, like, that he went, this is how we're going to... And again, like, I know this is going to sound so repetitive, but world building, like... You're going to be in these spaces and we're going to film them in a way where you see glimpses of a lot of stories happening. A lot of stories you're never going to really know what they are. And we're not going to tell you them because it's just what you need to know is this is the space they're in. There are a lot of different species and this is kind of what the place looks like. But the, you know, intentionality of that and, you know, and I understand asking, you know, to pit New Hope and Empire against each other, I do think is unfair. I can't necessarily say... I mean, I think I enjoy New Hope more because I'm a sucker for a good origin story. But, I mean, Empire, it's so well-paced. You know, you're in Hoth the exact right amount of time. Like, it doesn't linger there so long that you lose kind of what's special about this ice planet. And you know, they separate the characters.
They separated characters?
All right, relax.
All right,
we'll get there.
That's my one snarky comment.
We'll get there. But they separate the characters in a way that I still feel their stories are intertwined. And I don't think that's easy to do because of the fact that, like, what Luke is doing is so distanced from, you know, Han and Leia and, you know, the weird worm thing in the, you know, in the asteroid field, and, you know, going to Cloud City and meeting Lando Calrissian, and, like...
There's a scene. No, I'm glad you talk about that. Like, they land and, you know, it's really doesn't add anything to the story. But again, who doesn't remember that scene of them being inside the mouth of that... it probably has a name, and I apologize, but the worm-type creature...
I know what it is. I'm just not going to tell you.
Okay, that's fair.
That's completely what's happening right now.
You know, so, like, yeah, again, it's very world-building. You say that, and I agree with you. I think that's what Empire actually is really starts to do. You take that from Star Wars to the Star Wars universe.
No, 100%. And the thing is, it's kind of like, you know, to harken back to that in New Hope, do I need that trash compactor sequence? Hell no. But is it cool? And I get to see them in a moment of peril that gives me some character building. Because here's the thing. I love a well-placed characters are in peril, but it builds their characters so I understand how they would react in these different situations. Like, I like stuff like that. There's a lot done with, like, the romantic tension between Han and Leia within this particular sequence coming off of him being still, like, you know, super pissy about the fact that she kissed Luke on Hoth. And, like, you know, so you have this, like, really interesting tension, and I think that gets extrapolated. You know, so you have... I think it's well-paced in that way. So, thinking about Empire... Do you have a favorite sequence? Do you have, like, a favorite kind of portion of the storyline that you really attach on to?
If you had asked me this previously, I would say Hoth, but I have to go now Cloud City.
Shut up.
Why?
Because I also feel like Cloud City's my favorite.
We share one brain, folks. One show, one brain. And actually, I want to say this really quick before I forget. This is a moment where I have to give Lucas a lot of credit for tinkering with the films. What he adds to Cloud City really opens up that entire planet.
It does enhance it.
It enhances it completely. So, you know, as much as we want to get on him for things, there are moments that he does. Actually, two in this film, because unfortunately, the correction of Palpatine's hologram is huge, too. Because that hologram is rough in the original version.
Yeah, it really is. Yeah.
Because it wasn't played by the same actor. No. The makeup hadn't been, you know, decided on, obviously, or, you know, obviously they changed it for the better. So, like, those two moments are huge. But, yeah, Cloud City, it's beautiful. You get introduced to this really other cool character that can go toe-to-toe with Han, which is excellent. And then, obviously, we get the introduction of Boba Fett. you know, I like Vader in these scenes because I think you give more depth to that character.
Oh, he's so twisted.
Yeah. So.
He's so twisted. The thing is like, it's almost, I sometimes forget about the sequence when they're in Cloud City and he like sits down and talks to them. Like it's because it feels like it shouldn't be there because what you're used to is like him brooding, like marching down a hallway and his like theme songs playing in the background. Like that's, you get so conditioned to that when you have these other moments with Vader. It does feel very interesting. It does feel very character building. And I'll say about like Cloud City, Cloud City is beautiful. Like, so there's that aspect of it visually. It's really stunning. It has that like clean, like hyper modern aesthetic that like essentially, you know, like the Star Destroyers have, but like it's warm and inviting. Like it looks quote unquote futuristic, but you know, it's a future you want to be a part of. And I think what's really interesting about this sequence, like you said about the Lando thing, and I think why Lando's character is so important is because like the entertainment of Han being kind of this rogue scoundrel who like, you know, the Rick Blaine from Casablanca of it all, he doesn't stick his neck out for nobody. Like in New Hope works really well, but Han's character is starting to develop in a way where if it was just him doing that all throughout Empire would start to feel tired, but seeing someone else who exists on that same plane with him and them getting to play off of each other, I completely agree with you. I think it's really great for Han, and it also makes Lando such a compelling character.
And then obviously we get, you know, Han being put into carbonite.
No.
Yeah. And you have the huge Leia Han moment.
The best, well, no, I wouldn't even say, no, yeah, the best Leia Han moment. I'll say it.
The, what?
I love you.
I know.
Yeah.
Like a pimp, he says. I know.
Like a jerk face, he says, I know. He gets out of a carbonate, right. She should slap him up style.
I just want to say, my line is a Kevin Smith line, so I don't want anybody to think that I stole that. If they've ever heard that before, because I forget. That might have been in Lucas versus...
It is in the people versus George Lucas, most positive.
But do you know why that line gets written that way? Mm-mm. It's interesting. So the line was supposed to be something along the lines of... like, don't worry, I'll be back, or, like, you know, something. It essentially alludes to, like, you know, not to worry, but Harrison Ford wasn't signed on for 3 films and didn't have any desire, or didn't know if he had any desire to come back for a third film. So they changed it on the day of.
To be, I know.
Yeah, now there's kind of question on whether it was ad-libbed or Ford actually talked to Kirshner about it before they filmed. So either way, it was decided that day, which is, again, huge.
Well, and here's the thing. The ad-libbed story I had heard previously, I always favored that, you know, where that would be very cool for Harrison Ford, it feels too intentional for it just to be something that got ad-libbed. Because here's... the whole moment behind it. Leia's known the entire time that Han's in love with her. Mm. Han has not known if Leia's in love with him. So him saying, I know, is like, it's that recognition of like, oh, okay, I do realize that you love me. Like, and I kind of needed to hear that.
Right.
Because she already knows he's in love, which how could you not be? She's such a badass.
But we also have to give credit. I mean, because Harrison Ford, right? He has I don't know if he had lived it, but when he was sick on, Raiders and he shoots instead of, there's supposed to be a huge fight scene.
He had the flu.
Yeah.
He wasn't the only cast member that had, I forget if it was the flu or pneumonia. And a lot of the cast got really sick, but it was like so incredibly hot. He just needed the scene to be over. So he shoots, you know, when the guy comes out with like the saber and because he needed the scene to be over because he was so ill. And I mean, you see like he's sweating and you think it's part of the scene. No, he's like violently ill and needs it to be over.
Sorry, and the line he was originally supposed to say was, just remember that, Leia, because I'll be back.
I hate that so much.
Right.
But the problem is you're so conditioned to how cool that moment is. And the thing is like, I really appreciate a film because like, and you said this about how it becomes like so iconic in cinematic history because we've seen so many repetitions of this in a sequel or a mid part of a trilogy where you kind of end in a spot of peril. But what I appreciate about this is it was breaking new ground and territory of going, this part 2 is going to end and things are not looking good because Luke hasn't finished his training. Han is in carbonite and captured. We now have to figure out how we're, you know, we have now Darth Vader is Luke's father and we don't know what the implications of that are going to be. Is this hero that we've now followed going to somehow turn towards the dark side? It's an intense place of like despair, but even that, like, I feel like doesn't feel like despair in the end, which you got to give a lot of credit to, again, how the film ends, like with Luke jumping onto the ship. You have that great shot of him like holding onto the antenna in Cloud City, which feels terrifying. Him getting his hand back, like, and it's weird. So it's like this thing that like ends with everyone in like immense peril and the futures are so uncertain. But at the same time, you're kind of like, man, I think they'll be okay.
Oh, yeah. Well, you have that nice shot of Luke and Leia and R2-D2 and C-3PO looking out.
Yeah.
But this is, you bring us up and that's the thing. Those are the big moments that you have to talk about in this as, again, film history of, you know, not many people saw a film like this back then, which left you on such a negative cliffhanger, or a bummer cliffhanger, right?
Yeah, because Han's in carbonite!
Yeah, so that, you have this huge reveal. I mean, it's been so parodied now, and so quoted now, but again, like you said earlier, like, that I Am Your Father was huge. I mean, nobody expected that. Like, that was an epic moment. And some things that were kind of more behind the scenes, Lucas bucking the Hollywood system, right? Like, he financed this himself. Mm-hmm. He kind of bet on himself and won. He basically had to leave the Writers Guild because he refused to put the credits at the beginning of the film. Yep. They let him do it on New Hope, but because New Hope was so big that they didn't want him to do it on this, he didn't relent on that and essentially put himself... He did well for himself, he bet on himself, and he won.
Got that toy money.
Yeah. But, yeah, just these huge moments from this film. So it deserves all of the credit that it gets.
Completely. And now we come into... Episode 6, Return of the Jedi.
Yes, not quite as universally acclaimed and beloved, but still, I think...
Beloved.
Yeah.
I'm going to say not... Here's the thing. Empire Strikes Back...
Yeah, you're right. I'm making it sound like there's...
I don't think there's negativity surrounding it.
No, you're right.
I think there's jokes made about how much the Ewoks play depending upon the age at which you saw it. But other than that, no, this is a phenomenal ending to a chapter. And, you know, of course, the obvious is here. No one knew there was going to be a prequel trilogy and a sequel trilogy when this occurs. Like, you know, much is made about, like, how much Lucas had planned out. But you really didn't know that this was going to be anything beyond this. And this is an incredible ending to the series, which starts out with probably one of my favorite... And I know I just said this about Hoth, but I feel very much the same about this. This whole sequence... At Jabba's lair. Oh, man. Just so much happens. It's literally like an Italian, like, giallo film where it's, like, twist and turn after twist and turn. And there's this whole elaborate should-not-work subterfuge. You've got Luke, who cannot keep cool for shit in this moment. Like, he is literally giving way to the fact of, I obviously have more planned, guys. Like, it's so obvious. He's not Obi-Wan on Kamino. He is... totally loving every moment.
He's very Qui-Gon, though. Like, he's very Qui-Gon.
Yes. Yes. And I really enjoy it. I'm here for it. I'm not, like, being negative about it. But it's, like, this moment of, like, as soon as he walks in and he's doing kind of the quick Jedi mind tricks and, you know, and we get more clarification that it's, like, you know, again, we get that repetition of it's the weak-minded that can be tricked by it. But, like... he's so overly confident that he will be fine. And it's, you have this really seedy world where it's, you know, you have this woman who is chained up and, like, forced to dance. And I'm like, this is a kid's movie. And this is disturbing as all get up. You've got...
3.5 years old watching that.
I have, again, like 45 minutes of questions afterwards of how you process that as a 3-year-old. But, you know, it's, you've got...
Well, that would be a short episode for us.
But you've got that, like, subtle, like, Lando gets revealed to us. This is all paced so well and so exciting. Leia coming in and getting Han out of the carbonite, and he can't see because he's got hibernation sickness. And, like, but this, like, really great. You realize, like, she is really outsmarted, you know, Jabba and all of his guards in this moment, but unfortunately just really should have... moved him faster through this situation. You know, you have, I like the despair of, like, C-3PO because he really thinks they've been left, but, like, right. R2 knows the entire time. He's like, I've literally got the lightsaber in my tummy tum. Chill out, 3PO. But he, like, doesn't tell him, which is, like, so, like, it's kind of like a really, like, savage thing to do.
You can't trust C-3PO. He's gonna give that information up.
He totally is. Also, I really, and I don't know why this is maybe the first time I've picked up on it, the subtle synth music when, like, Luke enters, like, Jabba's, is it Jabba? I think it's, like, Jabba's palace or Jabba's home, however it's, like, referred to, but, like, when he comes in, there's, like, this subtle synth that's added to the score where you're like, oh man, he's like a Jedi now. Like, it's really, because the moment we leave him in is he's getting, like, his hand reattached and his best friend is in, like, severe peril and he hasn't finished his training.
Yeah, sorry, I was going to say that, yeah.
Oh, sorry, yeah.
No. And that was something we even didn't even talk, which was very cool about Empire, like, to have him leave the training the way he did, like, and then have to revisit that later in this film.
Yeah, and it's, I think it's just, like, this really great thing of, like, it essentially catches the audience up of, like, oh, okay, so he's full-on Jedi now. Cool, cool, cool. Yeah. Now I know how to enter the rest of this film. And it's like, and you go into this, like, I hate to say this, but this wretched hive of scum and villainy. It's so gross in there. They all just sleep in the same room.
Greek bar in Los Angeles, by the way.
Oh.
Scum and villainy.
Scum and villainy. If you ever have an opportunity on Hollywood Boulevard, truly the most excellent bar we've ever been to. Scum and Villainy Cantina. It literally looks like the Cantina from New Hope. It's amazing.
I am with you. This is probably maybe one of my favorite sequences in the entire franchise. Out of all the films, the Jabba stuff is great. It's all the credit to the puppeteering and everything, the costuming,
Salacious
the storytelling.
Crumb.
Yeah. I mean, again, like, you could take that segment and make it its just own little short film, and I'm totally down for it. That's great. Now, this is, we just talked about Empire, the positives to Lucas tinkering. This, though, is where he adds probably the worst one that he does.
That dumb song!
The song is just, the song number is so bad.
It takes all the air out of the, because here's the thing. without the song, that place is disgusting and weird and dark and strange. You add the song in and I'm like, wait a second. Why am I in Shrek 2? And all of a sudden, I'm to now completely change gears. Is the slave girl still dancing? This is messed up. Like it's, but it doesn't read villainous. It reads like, hey, the kids are watching. Like it's, I hate it.
It's goofy. It doesn't work at all. I don't know. Like, you just sometimes wonder if he's just laughing on the other end. Like, there's no way he watches that and thinks that that was good.
No, I have to imagine not.
But
I would hope anyways.
This part, though, also I get real geeked out about because, again, being a kid, I had all these toys. I had this great playset of Jabba and, like, how it would open up and you could put the figures into his pit. I had, like, a 3-foot Rancor, which was awesome and epic. It seemed huge. Like, this...
So jealous of this.
I also, and just, I'm going to say it because it's the other action figure from this film. I had a Sebastian Shaw Anakin Skywalker action figure, like as the Force Ghost looking.
Oh my God.
Mom had a mail away for that I got months later.
Right.
So like I had these action figures were my favorite of, you know, so yeah, I Return of the Jedi, but it slows down in the middle part. That's the one thing I'll say as an adult when I watch it. I find that it gets a little slower compared to the other two of the original trilogy.
Well, that punch of that opening sequence, like, because there's a lot of really comedic things that happen to, or aside from the weird, stupid song that gets added in, like, because I'm going to say this, like, I do think this is some of best comedic work by Harrison Ford across, like, he's always quippy and funny and, like, wry, but, like, this is, he's hilarious. Like, when he's like, I'm out for a little while and everyone gets delusions of grandeur and, like, or just even, like, how he, you know, he bumps Boba Fett, and so Boba Fett dies, like, or wait, sorry, he doesn't die, but, like,
well, right.
We now know he doesn't, but, like, I love, and I think that's the thing, you have such a pack of, it's action, it's Luke being, like, a full-on Jedi, it's all of these really great moments, great action, and then things have to kind of slow down for a while, which makes sense, but I completely get what you're saying is there's kind of that mellowing out to build back up to where we need to be.
I mean, because the end is terrific. I think it's one of the best lightsaber scenes between Vader and Luke, and
I think it's
raw. That's what I like about it. It's not choreographed as well. Like, it's just, you know, anger and just visceral fighting between the two. And just when Luke finally gets that rage in him and just starts going off on Vader.
Yeah.
Just cool.
It's incredible. And, like, because, you know, and it's underscored by the fact that you have this sequence prior with him and Yoda where, Yoda's dying or Frank Oz is getting tired, as you said earlier. And you have all of these great things that, like, Yoda imparts to him, like, already know that which you need. He tells him the last of the Jedi you will be, which becomes so much more epic, like, later on because of the titling of Episode 8. And, you know, he, like, essentially says him, like, you already know everything you need to know. Like, there's not this extra step that, so it gives him, like, all of that confidence, but not arrogance to, like, go into the fight that way, but also there's no way emotion doesn't get tied up because although, no, he has no bond particularly with this person, like, it's still, it's like, but this is where I came from. Like, everything that I kind of am came from this person that now I have to battle with. And then you have this whole other thing happening on, you know, you have everything that's happening on, you know, on Endor with the Ewoks, which is, like, really, really entertaining. So you have these, like, two things really, like, juxtaposed against each other of just, like, this great Star Wars battle with really, really cute, fluffy Ewoks and, like, C-3PO.
Poor cannibals. Well, I guess they're not technically out.
They're not cannibals. They just were gonna eat Han. Yeah, which Han's a snack, so I'm not blaming them, but, like, but you have, like, the whole C-3PO is God thing. Like, there's just a lot of great stuff that happens on
Wicked's
Endor.
Yeah, Wicked's great, man.
Wicked rules.
I love the Ewoks. I'm totally team Ewok. I'm with you.
But then you have, like, you know, and I agree with you, have this really great, you know, redemption story that happens because of this. You have this really aesthetically pleasing funeral that occurs. I hate saying that, but it's... And you get to have this really great, I love the really the tranquil nature of the conversation that ends this between Leia and Luke, of her, like, well, I guess I knew, like,
yeah,
like, I do know this already. It's just, I don't know, there's just something really beautiful about it ending in this, like, very, like, lush, verdant space of peace has been restored to the galaxy, and you get to see, like, the celebrations happening everywhere, yeah. And, you know, and Lando and Han both becoming generals by the end. Like, there's just so many cool things that happen by the end of this movie. It just feels like a really, like, warm, happy place to
yeah, and I, again, I like the addition of seeing the other planets and everything during the it celebration. It is a good addition. Yeah.
All right, so, I, you know, Force Ghost in the room. How do you feel about the changing of the Force Ghost?
Despite the fact that I had this Sebastian Shaw action figure.
You took that as a point of pride.
I now have come around to it. I didn't like it, but I actually think it works. And I feel ashamed for being so against it. And it's just a matter of we didn't want it to go away. But it makes more sense than anything yep. else the more you really think about it. Because the vision that he shows up as in... He's never really looked like that. He never has looked like that.
No.
So it doesn't really make a lot of sense of why he would appear in that form yeah. with how the films played out. It's fine when they're on their own, but now that we've had the prequels, I think that it makes more sense to have Hayden Christensen there. It doesn't look bad. It looks seamless. And I think it just makes a lot more sense.
I agree completely. And yeah. I also do think, I can't stress this enough, if you've not done it in its episodic order yet, you'll appreciate that moment a lot more when you're watching it episodically.
Also, for what it's worth, I also don't think the age matches up to, like, with what Hayden Christensen looks like, and then you're only talking about 20, 25 years, I don't think he looks as old as Sebastian Shaw looked in that version, so I don't think that makes a lot of sense either.
No,
so there's just some aspects of it that once I really start, I went, no, I keep that, I'm good with it.
Yeah. So we get to the end of Return of the Jedi, and then a period of darkness in, you know, the land between Revenge of the Sith ends, that prequel trilogy becomes much maligned, and then J.J. Abrams goes to San Diego Comic-Con and does a panel, and then takes an says to all of the Star Wars fans, get your lightsabers, we're going to the park, and John Williams is going to play the entire score of Star Wars, and thus ushers in a new era in the Star Wars galaxy of films, and we get Star Wars Episode 7, The Force Awakens.
And everybody's been pumped since.
And no one has ever said one complainy thing about yeah. this section.
I mean, it was exciting, right? Like, that time, if anybody was a Star Wars fan, it's at its height. Like, we were all pumped to have that back.
Well, and I mean, you know, and this is... because obviously I very much... support the Disney aspect of this, but you know, and the thing is, when people are like, oh, Disney's ruining Star Wars, it's like Disney's had its like claws in Star Wars for a really long time, guys. Like, stop pretending like you don't know it's been in the parks for a while. But I think the really cool thing is that Disney obviously wanted to steward this in a way where it felt like event cinema, and it was, there's going to be a massive toy drop. I mean, we got the Lego Falcon, yeah. like, you know, and there's going to be a lot of pomp and circumstance around this first film coming out. And so, full understanding, I have not one iota of ill feelings about these three films. And I'm going to talk about them in very excited ways. And if you're watching this and you're like, I can refute that, don't try. I feel very passionately about it. I am like a porg watching a friend get roasted. Like, I just
wonder how they're watching this. I'm a little concerned.
Oh my gosh, should I just say watching? I'm sorry about that.
It's so natural. I'm sure I've said it times too.
I don't know where you have cameras. But
what?
All right, let's go to The Force Awakens. So we open up on this epic. And while Ryan composes himself, let me shepherd us into the masterpiece that is The Force Awakens. Now, I'll say immediately, we have to be really economical with our time, because the way I can talk about Force Awakens could make a 15-hour podcast within itself, just because I feel very passionately about this film. Listen, I think you and I know straight away that the J.J. Abrams, Rian Johnson, J.J. Abrams set of films comes with some backlash. I think for a lot of reasons that I could refute and really disagree with. However, I feel like our time is best spent just really appreciating and loving these films and what we love about them most. And starting with Force Awakens, I mean, the opening sequence is incredible, and I could definitely talk hours about how quickly we get an understanding of who Poe is, who Kylo is, who FN-2187, otherwise known as Finn, is, who BB-8 is. The fact that we're even getting a stormtrooper's perspective in this film is already something that feels revolutionary and really tragic, to go, oh my god, stormtroopers are conscripted when they're children? This is awful. But as much as that opening sequence gives us so immediately, I think the origin point of Rey's story is probably the thing that I just want to soak in the most about this film. She lives in an AT-AT. I'm not calling it that. She scavenges for parts on, you know, Imperial Starship. She has, a rebel pilot stuffed animal that she has clearly made. She is marking off the days since she has been left. She's
Rey from nowhere.
Rey from nowhere, an X-Wing pilot's helmet. She is immediately someone who is quite literally carrying the history of this previous war on her shoulders, because it's something that, like, she really knows and appreciates. And she's in this pinky orange hue the entire time she's filmed on Jakku. She's immediately selfless and kind and hopeful. And she's exactly what you want in a protagonist. And that, to me, starts and I think subsists the brightest points of this trilogy. And I could go on and on. Ryan, what do you think of The Force Awakens?
I love it. I think it's like the rock and roller coaster. It takes off and then the wind's in your face as soon as that crawl hits and you're in it. You have Kylo stopping the laser, which we've never seen before. I know you love that. Rey is a fantastic character. I think J.J. Abrams was by far the best director to take over this franchise.
For sure.
He gave back what people wanted. One of the criticisms, or I'm going to call it cynicism, you know, of this film, is that it's too close to the New Hope. I know you disagree with that. I actually agree with it. However, yeah, it is. That's what we wanted. You didn't like the prequels for a lot of different reasons. Give us a little bit more of what we loved about the original trilogy. And I absolutely, it's a lot of familiar, but also a lot of unique, new characters, new places. I'm all in.
Yeah, and I mean, like, that slight disagreement aside, I think we just see a little bit of the development differently. But, like, the thing is, like, you're exactly right. Like, Abrams was the perfect person to do this because he's a fan. The love is clearly there. He wanted to pay homage to the history, but didn't feel the need for that to be the only thing driving this. In fact, the thing that's driving it the most are these new characters. You get to the end of The Force Awakens, and you're like, I want more with Poe. I want to know what's going to happen to Rey. What's going on with Finn? I don't want him to be hurt in the end. Like, there's so much. I mean, honestly, I could do for an entire movie about Maz Kanata, because I've got a lot of questions.
Yeah.
She has run that place for 1,000 years. And that's, to me, he gave back what so many of the complaints were. There were practical effects, practical sets, big old puppets, a lot of money put into this. And I think what he did, too, was to do the same thing that Lucas did so well. You're going to see these places and you're going to leave with more questions than you are answers. But that's kind of the charm of it, is you're not supposed to know everything.
Yeah.
We're going to focus these stories in a way. And I think I felt that the thing that Abrams did really well is he gave us stakes and made us care about these characters very quickly, and gave them backstories that were not overly complex, but felt deeply like they were reaching out to connect to you very early on in the film. And I think that's important, because, like, I really feel that Rey is devastated when Han Solo gets killed, and they haven't spent a lot of time together, but I feel like they give you enough to go, okay, I completely understand why she's devastated by this.
Were you shocked by Han's death?
Yeah, completely.
See, I wasn't.
I know you weren't.
But I thought it was still all earned.
Yeah.
Like, I still think that you gave me everything with that character to give him his send-off, and I thought it was really well done. And I like that he doesn't go out as a hero, necessarily. Like, he goes out trying to be a hero.
Yeah.
But you have this tragic fate for him.
No, but it's even so much more than that. He goes out trying to be a father.
Yeah.
And it's a really, like, hard thing to watch. Because, I mean, like, that's the thing is, like, Abrams does, and I'm sure we'll get to this sequence in a few moments here, but, like, you know, he gives us that great ending sequence with where, you know, where Rey goes. But certainly that part is really hard, because then you look at the character of Kylo Ren and you're like, there's no way they redeem this guy. And then I also remember you saying that about Han before the movie came out, and me going, no, they can't. And then when it happens, I really didn't think it was going to happen, but it worked really well. And I think, too, like, you build also the mythos of Rey in such a really cool way where, like, we don't know a lot about her, but you get the sense that she's important or has the spirit to be important in this, like, larger fight. You have those great lines that Maz Kanata says to her when she has, like, the lightsaber, and she's like, the belonging you seek is not behind you, it is ahead. And that becomes, like, a beautiful theme for the rest of this trilogy. And she says, the light it has always been there, it will guide you. Like, Rey, you have light within you, you just have to follow it, which becomes really important by the time you get to the third film for a lot of reasons. There's just something so special about this. You can't deny the excitement that was around this film. And I think the excitement that it created.
That original trailer. Oh my God. Right? I mean, I think, right, people are buying tickets just to go see the trailer.
Because
the movies and then leaving. Oh, yeah. I mean, I think, it's awesome.
Do you remember buying tickets for the movie and how tense that was? It was during the Monday Night Football game.
Was that one?
Or yes.
Was that Last Jedi?
No, I believe was that it? Was, oh, okay. I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that was, I feel like it was an Eagles game. It was Monday Night Football.
I remember that being for one of them. I can't remember.
I'm almost positive it was Force Awakens. And we were like panicking because we were like, we have to see this on opening night. And I, you know, and listen, certainly the next film we're going to talk about.
Well, before what's your favorite part of Force Awakens? Is my favorite thing.
I really love the relationship between Rey and Finn. It's something I really enjoy about the film because I think they very clearly establish, like, no, the series can go on without you needing the original characters at play. I really love that. So this part's going to be selfish. The end's shot. And the selfishness is that so it ends on the planet Octo, which is where Luke Skywalker has been in hiding, I guess, is the best way to describe this. And it's this moment of her, like, climbing these steps up this, like, amazing, like, picturesque island. You and I got to go there. And I'm sure I'll post pictures on Instagram about this. And I've posted things about it before. But I love that shot. I love how epic it feels. I love how it could feel really unfinished, but I don't feel like it is. I don't feel, like, yes, I'm anticipating that next part, but I also feel really satisfied by that part. What about you? Do you have a favorite part of Force Awakens?
If I broke it down to one strange scene, and that is when Kylo Ren takes off the helmet. Because I love the decision that you assume, because we know what we know about Darth Vader.
Yeah.
What's going to be under the mask? Oh, yeah. And I love that it ends up being, no, he's just wearing the mask. I think it tells so much about that character, and that is a moment in that film that I was like, I'm in. I like what you're doing here. I do.
Because it makes him a really compelling villain. Mm-hmm. I also think it's really cool to, like, see him, how he, like, obsesses over his grandfather's mask.
Yeah.
So that's clearly why he has his own. But then, like, also additionally, it's like, oh, but if you know the history of it, like, you know your grandfather redeemed himself in the end. So it really shows, like, radicalization and, like, how twisted he could make that history in his mind to go, I'm going to finish your work. And it's like, that's not what Vader wanted in the end.
Right. And it's real reminiscent of, like, kids that play sports and, like, they find their, like, you know, I was a wrestling family, but, like, you find your dad or your grandfather's headgear and you put it on, or their shoes. Like, that's what this reminds me of.
Yeah.
This, like, he's trying to have this connection with this grandfather because he feels some type of connect, you know, obviously force connection to him. I think it's a cool, really cool character building portion of the film.
Yeah, he just really twists what's being said, what's being, like, reached out to him. And then this, you know, this takes us into The Last Jedi, where we get much, you know, deepening of the Kylo Ren, I mean, deepening of all of the characters. You know, The Last Jedi is much debated about. We're a pro Last Jedi household. And I'll turn this to you, because I know you love The Last Jedi. So, as this is an all-positivity celebration in honor of Revenge of the Fifth, what do you kind of point to as the thing you love the most about The Last
Get
Jedi?
Get out of here, haters! Okay, but seriously, can you repeat your question?
So, what is it that you love most about The Last Jedi, or how do you want to kind of defend this really, really divisive Star Wars movie?
It is. It seems to have become the, you either love it or you hate it. I am in the love category. I will openly admit that I do, and I think that it is by far the best directed of all the Star Wars films. I love the back-to-back between this and Force Awakens, because Force Awakens gave you the familiar, and then this one turned all of that on its head and gave you something unique and took all your expectations, and it completely subverted them. And I love that about it. I love the decisions that they were trying to do. Ultimately, it's the theme of the film that I think speaks to me the most, which to me I think is it's like the internal fight of one's demons and finding balance in that to understand your place and legacy in the universe. And to me, that speaks so much to this film. It speaks to me personally. It speaks to all of these characters, and I just absolutely give so much levity, so much soul to each of these characters. And then I just think it's shot amazingly. I mean, just I people don't like Canto Bight. I think that's cool. I love his decision to basically give homage to Wings, Oscar winning film, Wings, 1929, to bring us into that.
Yeah, it's a really cool shot.
I love Rose Tika. She's one of my favorite characters in the entire, you know, Star Wars universe, because I think she is us, the fans. Mm-hmm. Even though I think people miss that, she's just somebody that's just trying to do everything she can to help in the smallest ways possible. And then she, you know, she loves all these people, you know, kind of what you were saying about Rey, but I think even to another degree. But I mean, maybe they're very, you know, equal in that, but I think she's a bright spot of this film. Again, kind of like you were talking with Force Awakens, I could sit here and do a whole show just on Last Jedi and how just genius I think it is. And I have watched that movie many, many times, and I just can't understand why people hate it. Not about liking it or not liking it, but hate it. I just don't understand.
You know, and I think, you know, you talking about this at the beginning of our first part of this about, like, kind of putting expectations aside, I really honestly think it comes down to this. You're right, it felt different than a lot of Star Wars films. But I don't think it's dissimilar as oftentimes we can kind of push it off to be. I also think really what it comes down to is I just don't think anyone anticipated that that was going to be Luke's story. And I think that's the thing that really, like, nests in people and kind of darkens their feelings about this. Like, I really do think that Luke not somehow mysteriously yet being gone from this fight for so long, but he's actually planning some hopeful return, I think really bothered people. And I get why, but I also feel like if you follow Luke's character development, it's actually not that big of a stretch to see, like, where this would be so disheartening. His nephew turns on him. His nephew goes to the dark side. That has to be traumatizing. Look what happened to Yoda. Yoda goes to Dagobah because of what happens with Anakin. Like, and I think you get the sense that the Knights of Ren and Kylo went through the new Jedi temple and killed a bunch of younglings in the wake. Like, you get that sense from those flashbacks. We don't get that story fully fleshed out.
Yeah, I'm with you.
But I also think there's just really beautiful things about this film, and I think things that we can all agree upon, or at least I hope. Crate is one of the most amazing visually sequences with that, you know, the salt breaking apart to the red. Yeah. It's incredible. The throne room lightsaber battle. Oh my gosh. That is
awesome.
It is so awesome. How Snoke gets killed is just incredible.
Yes, I know people hated it again, but I just thought that was so, like, who the heck saw him killing Snoke halfway through this film and in such a way, and you give such a rise to Kylo Ren.
Oh, yeah. And I love the fact that, like, this repetition that becomes of, like, Rey won't take Kylo's hand. And because this becomes really important in Rise of Skywalker and gets repeated a few times, like, I don't know, I just think there's so many cool things. Now, granted, I love the sequences, as, you know, because of the reasons I said at the end of Force Awakens on Octo, I love the Jedi scrolls. I love the fact that we see the Jedi texts again, because we saw what the library looked like in Revenge of the Sith, or sorry, an Attack of the Clones, and now we get to see, like, just the last remaining text, the tree, Yoda reappearing. Like, there's so many things that happen in this that, like, the people who are like, oh my gosh, Force Awakens is just a fan service. I'm like, and this isn't? And now this you hate? Like, it's very confusing to me.
Well,
and I think people have their feelings about this. And again, we're not here to try and, like, litigate, like, you have to feel this way about Star Wars. I just think there's more to The Last Jedi that people easily pass off.
Yeah, it's, you know, I heard somebody once say it's a great film, just not a Star Wars film. I just can't agree with it. I just think it, again, expands on the entire universe. I think the Canobite stuff is really genius. I think it kind of plays a lot to what we saw in the prequels and bringing that into fold. I think it's interesting to see, you know, some other aspects of going, you know, bringing in about war and how, you know, a lot of times war is about money and yeah, where that's,
and there are people sitting pretty while you're all having this fight, yeah, you know?
And then it's ultimately a film about hope.
Yeah.
Where that film ends is just magic to me.
Yeah.
It made me feel like a kid. Like, I left that theater going, yes, like, yeah, when you have that little kid looking to the stars and he turns the broom, every single one of us that is a Star Wars fan was that kid.
Yeah, and if you are saying that you didn't use a broom to pretend it was a lightsaber as a kid, you were lying to yourself.
Right, and most of us looked like that poor kid that got a viral video.
Yeah, I mean, I still look like that when I wield a lightsaber. I have not improved. But I even love, like, the moment before when the kid is telling the story. Like, you see, yes, how the folklore kind of builds. And although, like, yeah, I think you and I have recently discussed, because I don't want to end this in a negative space, there were, like, kind of two shots in the film. One shot that you find kind of objectionable, one shot that I find objectionable. But no matter how you feel about those parts that are down notes about this, like, it ending in that moment where hope has been restored and people are going to feel this renewed spirit in the resistance, you got to get behind that.
Yeah.
Because then it leads us to,
well, I just want to say, you're right. It's not a perfect film, as much as I love it, but none of these are, which we've talked about. Yeah. I also need to, I think people need to be reminded sometimes, we're watching these films at different times of our lives.
Oh,
with
for sure.
Different sensibilities at different, most of us saw the original trilogy when we were kids. We're going to view these sequels with different eyes and different sensibilities than we did as youth. So sometimes the heroes that we have and the things that we build up aren't going to be the exact same. And I think that's okay, because ultimately all these characters still land where you want them to.
Yeah, and my objection, I'll say, with, like, the end, I would have loved if they kept Luke alive. I would have loved if he still did all of that but survived. That's just me wanting Mark Hamill around, yeah, for another movie. I mean, that's selfish on my part.
I don't disagree with you, but I also think the fact that he sacrifices himself and shows this immense power is a nice send-off to that character and gives us what we get in Rise of Skywalker because of it.
And then that leads us into, with Rise of Skywalker, and we get to see this continued tension. It's actually a tension that's been used throughout the series, of the tension of the devotion to the Jedi Order versus the fight of the rebellion or the resistance. You see this in the prequel trilogy. Amidala questions the Jedi quite frequently. It's an interesting tension that happens. Respects the Jedi, but questions kind of their methods. You see Luke having to leave to go to Dagobah to do his training, but then ultimately comes back to, like, you know, help his friends. And you get that tension right from the beginning, because, which is so amazing, we've got Rey. She's being trained by Leia. So even before we get that information later, we know at some point that Leia was trained in the ways of the Jedi.
Yeah.
She's getting trained by Leia. You've got Finn and Poe out there, resistance fighters, you know, doing the best they can with this understanding. And then we kind of get the big piece of information that Palpatine is back. All right. Now here, how Ryan feels about The Last Jedi is how I feel about Rise of Skywalker. And I'm going to be very honest and forthright here. The first time I saw Rise of Skywalker, I had issues. And then the second time I watched it, I absolutely loved it and then became an incredible ardent defender of The Rise of Skywalker. And mine really came back to Palpatine. I was like, why do we have Palpatine back? First off, I hate this character. I don't need more Palpatine. It makes no sense. This is stupid. Like, I felt really, I was stamping my feet. I'm like, we don't need this part. So that to me was a hard sell. I do feel like I feel very differently about it now. But we get this story that then becomes kind of what was the complaint with Last Jedi. Now we get Rey and Poe and Finn and C-3PO and BB-8 all together going on adventures, which was some of the complaint of Last Jedi, is that you separated these really interesting characters. So one of, to me, my high notes of this film, and it happens really early, it's the Festival of the Ancestors. This is on Pasana in the Midlian Valley, I think it's called. That whole sequence is so beautiful. Now, all right, granted, there's a lot of heavy plot stuff that happens. I'm like talking about the dancing and the Festival of the Ancestors. I love it.
Yeah.
It's so cool. Like, I want to be at that party. I love that they do a little character building with Rey because she has, you know, the issue of like not knowing where she's from. I love that section. And I just think it's so immediately awesome. You get the reintroduction of Lando, which is great. And then, you know, force lightning coming out of her hands and killing Chewie. So do you have things like immediately that you liked about Rise of Skywalker? I know you felt a little differently or still feel a little differently about Rise of Skywalker.
I don't actually, which is news to you.
What?
Release expectation, release ownership. I didn't do that the first time.
You didn't? No, because it was very tense.
I absolutely hated the movie when I left the theater.
You really did. It was awkward.
We were two other people, and I didn't say a word. Everybody was talking about what they loved about it, and I spoke not a word because I didn't want to rain on everybody's parade. And that's because I loved Last Jedi so much, and I felt that they did a little fan service and they did a little course correction, and I didn't like it. That wasn't fair of me. That wasn't me being a good fan. And that's why now I'm happy to have seen this film a few times, because now I'm able to watch it with completely different. I know where the story's going. I don't have expectations, and I can sit back and enjoy it. Seeing it in succession with the other films, it works to me. I'm not saying it's perfect. There are things that I still wish had been done differently. Rose Tika being benched a little bit bothers me.
I don't see it that way anymore.
I know. Okay, and I won't, let me get off the negatives, because we're getting close to the end of the show, and we've had such a great time. The highlight, what I'm trying to say is, I actually really, really like this movie now.
Good.
You've won me over.
Thank you, because I have sat there and watched you watch the movie, which I, listen, can't be comfortable, because you know I'm like looking at you like, start liking Rise of Skywalker. There's so much I love about this film. Yeah, it's not like I threatened him, but I feel like I threatened him with my eyes and my vibes. I love the whole sequence, you know, the Sith Wayfinder and having to go find that. I love that whole sequence. You get the Rey having to just, like, it's this great mirroring of, like, Luke having to fight the dark side version of himself and Rey having to do that. I love that sequence. I love, you know, getting introduced to the character of Janna. I wanted more. I will say, that's the one thing. I don't see the Rose Tika thing the same way as, like, that she gets benched. I think you understand. No, her importance is that she is someone who's an engineer, and it makes more sense for her to be doing that stuff.
I'm not saying it doesn't make sense from a story standpoint.
It does make sense from a story standpoint.
I mean,
yeah, unfortunately, this was some backlash from fans. Now, there are some things that you felt were really course correction. I don't exactly feel that way. I feel like these are things that JJ probably, when he picked up the story, this is just the way the story went in his mind, which makes sense with Force Awakens. And
even the Palpatine of it all doesn't bother me anymore.
No, it doesn't bother me now.
Now that I know it, you know, yeah, I wish they would have given a little more, but I know, we know that they probably weren't planning on bringing him back, so that's why we don't get any type of clues that he's coming, but I don't mind it.
But the thing is like, it serves to go, okay, so this is the thing that has to be defeated. It's a familiar evil, but I think it's more representational of the Sith as a whole. And then I think the fact that Kylo is not the ultimate Sith in the end, like, he isn't the big bad by the end of the movie. I think then it's just like, it becomes this like, no, it's literally just about defeating this evil.
Yeah, you can't get that arc with Kylo if we don't have a bad that overtakes him. And I think that's why bringing Palpatine into the mix actually plays really well and important.
And the first time I watched it, I was with you. I'm like, why? I don't want to buy into Palpatine's been pulling the strings, but I'm like, yeah, but I mean, hasn't he always all along? And I don't even think it's about him pulling the strings. I think it's more about just going, no, the Sith were always there, and he was the head of the Sith. So therefore, his presence, just like Force ghosts are always there, providing guidance. Unfortunately, he was always there turning the tides, to be able to support kind of the evil agendas of the Sith. And then him appearing at the end, I don't know if I'm with you. It doesn't bother me the way it did the first time. And at that, like, I really loved the movie the first time I saw it. I didn't like the Palpatine, but I've come really around on it, especially watching it kind of develop across the 9 films when you think about it in that way. And I love some of the stories we get, like Janna and the other, you know, stormtroopers who have rebelled. That's such a cool storyline to me because it shows that, you know, like that what Finn did, he had to do by himself, but there are other people who are inspired and then did the same thing. And I think that's really cool. The real tragedy of this all is, of course, how they had to handle Leia's passing, which was handled with so much class and grace.
They did. If anybody has a complaint about that, I just don't understand it, because that is incredibly difficult, but they gave such a service to her as an actress, as a person, as a character, just all.
And I'll say, like, one of the things I really love, like, I love, because of what happens in the throne room in the previous film, I love that final sequence with Kylo and Rey fighting together when she drops the lightsaber to him and he takes on the Knights of Ren and then he comes in. And I love, you know, I mean, here's the thing, the worth of this film, if nothing else, is hearing all those Jedi talk. That whole speech that happens at the end. And when she's like, and all the Jedi were within me, and she kills Palpatine, and, you know, in symbolically a lot of ways, because you see all the robes fall, like, killing the Sith. I don't know. Like, it gives me chills to think about it. The reunion of Poe and her and Finn at the end. I cry every time. Like, and I've seen this now, because once they, like, hug each other, you're like, oh, yeah, man, they have really been through it together. Like, I think it's incredible.
Couple moments, right? The Chewie finding out about Leia is heartbreaking.
That one hurts.
That one does. Him getting the medal, finally.
Which is just the best redemption of all.
Yeah. But I agree with you. I love the end. But I like all everybody fighting together. They finally, everybody stands up and fights back. I love that it's this huge, messy, epic, big, you know, finale.
You have no idea what's going on.
Yeah, and that's the way it should be. I you know, all the characters doing, working together, separately, together. Yeah, and also the thing we haven't talked about, and I know I'm going to step on your toes here because I know it's one of your favorite, the lightsaber scenes. That lightsaber scene on the Death Star between Kylo and Rey is just fantastic.
It's so beautifully shot.
So well done. Huge to the story, but also just, oh, with the, because so many times films or action sequences that are shot in rain are to cover things up. They're not
able
to. But this is not done that way. That whole scene is terrific.
No, and I'm glad you brought that up because I would have forgotten to mention that. And like, because you have, and it has so much, that moment has so much weight. You have Rey, who is the embodiment of good. She kills Kylo and then immediately realizes what she's done and knows that Leia has passed and then heals him immediately and then has that great line, I wanted to take your hand. I wanted to take Ben's hand. Like, oh my gosh. Like, the emotional weight of that moment is so incredible. And it's also just so beautifully shot. And it's this epic thing, like, you have, like, the showdown of good and evil quite literally happening on what we thought was the new hope of evil finally being destroyed. Like, it's just an incredible, incredible moment. And I think that's what I love about this film is, like, you cannot deny the scale of and the weight of every moment in this movie. And I think when I say I want more, it's just because I'm like, oh, you're giving me these cool moments with some of these characters. Give me a little more because I want... I would have been fine. Give me a 4-hour... finale. I'm fine with it. I'll sit through it.
Yeah, I mean, this film I actually think could have used an extra hour and I would have been there for it. I want to really say, highlight, I mean, all of the actors, obviously, but Adam Driver's so good. So good.
He's so phenomenal.
What, you know, him at the end of Last Jedi and then also what he does in this film, and my favorite moment of the entire Rise of Skywalker
is when he smiles.
To take that character, what you've put him through, what he's been, and then you just give him that moment of humanity before.
It's a little smirky poo.
It's so good. It's so, so genius, so good. I really enjoy it. And then the finale. No. Abrams knew how to end this movie. And the
Twin Sunsets, roll credits.
Skywalker Saga.
And the thing is like, you know, and I heard, you know, certainly there's always been, but here's why I love that she's a Skywalker in the end. Because it's the principles, the set of values, and the hope that she most ascribes to. And there's something really incredible about that. Because you and I were just recently talking about, like, there's something so significant that Leia stays Organa. She, you know, she stays loyal to the family that raised her, who inspired her to be, or inspired or encouraged her to be a rebel, to be a leader. And then you have Rey kind of looking at the scope of her life and going, the Palpatine name does not suit me, but the Skywalker one does, because, you know, there are three Skywalkers who are so significant in my development as this person. And then, you know, it being the rise of Skywalker, because I think, you know, there were a lot of thoughts of, and implications of what that might mean. But I think it's the rise again of that ideology. It's, you know, there's an anticipation that, okay, so Rey is going to go make a temple. She is going to train the next generation of Jedis. Hopefully nothing will go wrong. Or hopefully something does go wrong, because then we'll get more movies. But, you know, her putting the lightsabers together back on Tatooine, you know, how they should have grown. They should have grown up together. Putting them back there and her just walking and just so confidently saying, Rey, Rey Skywalker. And then just her and BB-8 going into the sunset.
The Force ghosts of Luke and Leia, which you need.
So emotional.
Yeah, I think it's... And there's something really wonderful and I think speaks to the entire franchise about found family. I think there's something beautiful 100%. In that. And I think that's something that he found in the finality, you know, of this and her choosing to take that name.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Let's just go watch Rise of Skywalker like right now. Mainly because my hype...
Can I watch Last Jedi then Rise of Skywalker?
Yes, of course, fine. But my hype level that you feel differently about this, I can't even explain to you. But I think this is the thing, you know, the beauty of the Star Wars franchise, taking all 11 films, taking the cartoons, the novels, the TV shows, like everything with it is like, the thing is it gives you people to root for and it gives you reason to have hope. And man, don't we all need that constantly? We all need reminders of the things we want to be are within our reach if we only believe in ourselves and pursue things with goodness in our heart and hope in our eyes. Like, that's what Star Wars does. And it just teaches generation after generation to have those feelings apply into their own life, you know, about choosing the good, but how hard that choice is. You know, Star Wars doesn't try to pretend like, well, no, just be a good person. That's so easy. Like, it lets you understand, like, no, it is easy to give into these things, to give into these weaker impulses, darker impulses, but there's always the hope of redemption. Like, these films teach us so much and are just such an incredible inspiration. It's hard not to love them. That's why I find it sometimes hard, even when I want to kind of joke around about some of their flaws. I kind of almost don't want to. Just
yeah, a couple
of
times while we were watching
it.
These, I was trying to make little quips, and I could see you give me the evil eye of like, no. So to kind of close out this epic saga podcast, why don't we do just some fun kind of summon up quick fire questions to
like
each
it.
Other. All right, do you want to go first?
Yes.
Okay, go
what
ahead.
Is your favorite planet location?
Cloud City. Beautiful.
Oh, fantastic. Mine is Hoth. I like the cold.
Nice.
It fits my personality.
Do you have a favorite sidekick character in the films?
Yeah, Chewbacca.
Yeah, it's hard to argue with that. But I'm going to go Rose Tika.
Of course you are. What's your favorite lightsaber duel?
Oh, mine is going to be the throne room. I think that is just shot and it's stunning. Love it. It's very visual, but yeah.
No, it's an incredible. It's probably one of the best visual lightsaber sequences in terms of like how it shot. Duel of the Fates, Qui-Gon, Darth Maul, Obi-Wan.
That score alone. No,
yeah.
Favorite villain.
Darth Maul.
Gotcha. The correct answer is Darth Vader, but I'm gonna go General Grievous.
Darth Vader's the understood number one.
Yeah.
What is your favorite chase sequence in Star Wars?
I talked about it before. I'll go Attack of the Clones. I think the start of that is pretty cool. It's good character building, and it's a cool scene to watch.
Their relationship.
Yeah.
Mine is the speeder bike sequence on Endor.
Yeah, that's a good pick. That's a very good pick. Do you have a favorite droid?
R2-D2. No, you can't answer anything else for this. Don't answer.
I do. It's BB-8. You know why? You know who voices BB-8? Mr. Ben Schwartz, people. Mr. Ben Schwartz.
You know, I didn't think it was going to happen this episode, but there it did. So what is... So there are the Galaxy's Edge... The Disney Parks has a, you know, a Star Wars theme lamp. The Galaxy's Edge. What is a location you would most want to see in the parks?
Oh, I'm going Hoth. Yeah. I mean, that would be awesome to look at. You can get, you know, Tauntaun rides and then like a dark ride where you kind of go in through the Wampa Cave. Yeah.
I'm not giving my answer because that's too perfect. I can't see it any other way.
I'm an Imagineer, people. favorite line through the...
Oof, that's really, really tough. I like Yoda's wisdoms and like kind of the backwards nature of his sentence structure, the do or do not, there is no try. I just love how iconic that is. That is
very iconic.
My other would be, it was the Maz Kanata line that I quoted earlier, the light has always been there, it will guide you.
It's a beautiful inspiration. Yeah, line. How about you? I like that. Mine is not an iconic line. Oh gosh. Mine is Empire Strikes Back.
Okay.
I love when Han is going out on the Tauntaun to find Luke. Some guy yells to him, your Tauntaun's gonna freeze to death. And he yells back, then I'll see you in hell.
Next year, can we just please do a whole episode just about best Han lines? Because there's just about a million. It
kills me every time.
It's really funny.
Your question?
I think that's all I had.
That's all you got?
Yeah.
All right, cool. Fine, well, let's finish it out this way. Favorite hero?
Leia. General Leia Organa, or Princess Leia Organa, however you want to refer to her. She'll always be a general to me.
Just a beautiful character.
Yeah, and I think that's, you know, I would say she, you could really make an argument that she's the central character of the saga. I just really love the development that's there, but I love that she arrives on the scene. You know, Luke has to go through like a very specific development, but her development is like, she starts in a space of like, I'm a rebel princess. I am here to save people. And then she only deepens and grows in her leadership from there. It's a really cool character.
And I agree with you. I think she might be the hero of the entire franchise. But I would pick different. I'm gonna go Luke Skywalker. He is Star Wars to me. And I love his entire arc from the moment we meet him as a young kid, you know, just wanting to go to the Tashi station to the point where he, you know, saves the rebellion. So, yeah.
Love that.
So, yeah, that's kind
he
of
our... He flicks the dust off his shoulders.
Yes. I just think he... Yeah, Luke Skywalker is
finally brings the X-Wing out of the water. That whole sequence when he's probably my favorite Force ghost.
So, you know, yeah, we're Luke and Leia. I mean, in the
ending
end of the day,
it where we should.
Yeah. So finally, close it out. Gonna put each other on the spot.
Okay.
Give our quick rankings of all the films we've watched, we've talked. They'll be different tomorrow. They'll be different next year when we do another Star Wars show. What's, do you want to go first with your 11?
I just want to say, Ryan has made me do this like several times, just like on our own, like before we had a podcast. Mm-hmm. And my answers have changed every time. So I'm going to go starting with 11 and moving all the way up to 1. 11 for me is Phantom Menace. 10 is Attack of the Clones. 9 is Solo, A Star Wars Story. 8 is Revenge of the Sith. 7 is Last Jedi. 6 is Rogue One. 5 is Empire. 4 is Rise of Skywalker. 3 is New Hope. 2 is Return of the Jedi. And number 1 is Force Awakens. And the reason you heard him whoop is not necessarily because of where Last Jedi is positioned. It's because the last time we had this conversation, I think I had it at like number 3. Every time I watch the Skywalker saga, my order changes.
I don't blame you on that. And we're both gonna get crushed for where we put Empire. I'm not gonna lie to you, everybody listening to this show,
I put it in episode 5.
Yeah, so did I. I'm about to give my list.
Oh jeez. I thought we talked about this. One of us had to rank Empire higher, or else we were incurring the wrath of our fans.
And fairly so. I mean, it is maybe the best.
It really is. You know, I'm just
so we're going with favorites, right? Like that.
Yeah, I'm just going to change my rankings real quick. But you go ahead.
11, Phantom Menace. 10, Solo. 9, Attack of the Clones. 8, Revenge of the Sith. 7, Rise of Skywalker.
Oh, I'll kill you.
6, Return of the Jedi.
Oh, wow.
5, Empire Strikes Back. 4, Force Awakens. 3, Rogue One.
He's gonna do it.
No, I'm not. Number 2, The Last Jedi. And number 1, A New Hope. It is the movie that you can watch without any seeing any of the other films. It is its own film, and we don't get any of the others without.
You can laugh to it. You can cry to it. Rock out to it. But I agree with, you know, here's the thing. Even when you're saying your rankings, I'm like, oh, wait, his rankings do make sense, except for he put Rise of Skywalker. That's shenanigans.
And again, tomorrow morning, I'll give you a whole completely different ranking. Will
change. But that's the beauty of Star Wars. It grows and it changes the more times you watch it, and it just opens up like a beautiful flower. Yep, that's right. I said that metaphor. So if you're not already following us on Instagram, please follow us at How Could You Podcast, on Twitter at How Could You Pod. You can send suggestions to howcouldyoupodcast@gmail.com. Please do us a favor and subscribe, leave a review. It really helps our visibility to other interested podcast listeners. Next episode, we settle our Oscars bet. We are not telling you how we're settling that. You're just going to have to tune in to find out.
And until next time, love fandoms, be good fans, and may the Force be with you always.